Jeremiah chapter 18 this morning, please, and verse number 1. I want to preach you a message entitled, The God of the Second Chance. The God of the Second Chance. Jeremiah chapter number 18 and verse 1. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, Arise, go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause thee to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels. And the vessel he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter, so he made it again. Another vessel has seemed good to the potter to make it. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter, saith the Lord. Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are ye in mine hand, O house of Israel. Father, anoint me to preach your holy word. Not to try to do it in the arm of the flesh, but do it the unction of the Holy Ghost. The people in this house this morning and people watching this right now that need what I'm about to say. And I pray that you'd bless it, anoint it, break it, and send it forth as the bread of life. In Jesus' name, amen. This is for who it is for. It is for someone. No question about that. I want to call your attention to where the Bible says, He made it, verse number 4, again. Another vessel, the potter and the clay. We are the clay in the hand of the potter. God knew why he brought me into this world. The Apostle Paul said he separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace. That's what he did for me. He separated me from my mother's womb and he called me by his grace, or I wouldn't be in here this morning. Take no credit for anything. God was good to me, and he came to me. So he said he made it again, another vessel. How'd he do that? Well, number one, he did it by buying her back. The book of Hosea, chapter number 3, verse 1, the scripture tells you that he went down and he bought Gomer back. Why'd he do that? Luke, chapter number 4, says this, And the devil said to him, All this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me. And whomsoever I will, I give it. And there are people today crying out to Satan for that power, and he's giving it to them. But in the process, they're selling their soul to Satan, for he lays claim on it. Make no mistake about that. But so therefore, the Lord had to buy back Gomer. Why? Because Satan is running this world right now. He's the god of this world. Secondly, how is he going to make Israel again? He's going to do it by raising her from the dead. Ezekiel chapter number 37, the hand of the Lord was upon me, carried me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley, which was full of dry bones. Only God can look at a dust pile and bring eternity out of it. Only God can look at what may appear to be total ruin and do something for the glory of God. He caused me to pass by them round about. Behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said unto me, Son of man, here's the question. Can these bones live? He's the God of the second chance. You say, I've blown it. There's no way God could ever use me again. I've asked him too many times to forgive me for the same sin. There's no way God is going to put up with that any longer and forgive me for the same sin. How many am I talking to? You've asked God to forgive you for a sin, go back and do it again. And then you say to yourself, my, I must be the biggest hypocrite that ever lived on the face of the earth. What you need is help. You need help from God. And that's not within you to do it. But the Bible said, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. He said to me, watch this. Prophesy unto these bones and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. I'm a messenger. That's all I am. But I'm giving you something today that can change your life completely. The power is not in this vessel of clay. The power is in the Word of God. If you're willing to accept it, my friend, God's able to do above and beyond. all you could ask or think. And then he cleansed her of her iniquity. That's how he brought her back. In the book of Zechariah, chapter number 3, verses 1 and 2, he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. Make a note of that. Standing to resist him. You see, Joshua is about to be cleansed. He's about to be changed. He's bearing the iniquity of the whole nation. And he comes before God with it. And therefore he becomes the representative of righteousness in Israel. And he's the only one that can do it. And so Satan is standing there to resist him. He wants you to think you're unclean and stay unclean. He wants you to think you're a drug addict and there's no hope for you as a drug addict. He wants you to think that regardless of what you say, what you do, you cannot change. Let me tell you something. You cannot change, but God can change you.
Amen.
Amen. Our problem today is that we want the glory and the praise for anything that happens in our lives so we can stand up and brag about it to other people. Well, let me tell you this morning, I am what I am by the grace of God. Hallelujah. So he said Satan was standing at his right hand to resist him. And the Lord said, the Lord rebuke thee, O Satan. Even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? So therefore God is going to restore Israel to himself again. Listen to this from Proverbs chapter 24, verse 16. A just man falleth 7 times and riseth up again. Amen. 7 times and riseth up again. And if you've been knocked down, knocked down, knocked down again, failed again, failed again, and you say to yourself, I must be an absolute and complete total failure. Here's what he said in John 15. Without me ye can do nothing. We're all failures without the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We can't do a thing. Many of the servants of the Lord, his best servants, have had times, my friend, where they were knocked flat on their back. Their whole ministry looked like that it was completely lost and a waste of time, that they'd missed their calling. And yet God is able to bring up out of the ashes something for the glory of God. The world imitates it with the phoenix, this bird that rises from the ashes. Let me tell you something. The Lord Jesus can bring you up from the ashes. Matthew chapter 18 verse 12 says this. How think ye, if a man have 100 sheep and one of them be gone astray, doth he not leave the 99 and goeth into the mountains and seeketh that which is gone astray? Aren't you glad you got somebody seeking? And if so be that he find it, it verily I say unto you, he rejoiceth more of that sheep than of the 99 which went not astray. Even so it is not the will of your Father which is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. Not a one of you. He tasted your death and your death and your death and your death and bore your sin and your sin, your sin, your sin and my sin. He died for all men. Amen. And notice carefully, he goes out and he finds that sheep. Why? He's the shepherd. He's the great shepherd, the chief shepherd, the good shepherd. When they show him carrying a little lamb, that's good, because he does carry the lambs. If you've ever seen a picture of a cast sheep, there's a video on YouTube, a number of them. People that raise sheep will show them what's a cast sheep, preacher. It's a sheep that has been turned on its back, usually because it has a full growth of wool. And the ewes in the springtime have their little lambs. And so they're top heavy. And all it takes is just a little bit of stumbling and they fall. And they fall over and their little legs are kicking like this up in the air. And they can't get up. There they lie, flat on their back, with their legs kicking up in the air. That's a cast sheep. They'll lie there, and they say that gases build up in the abdomen pretty fast when they're like that, and it's only hours and they're dead. So the shepherd has to stay on them. He's got to watch them. He's got to stay. He sleeps with them at night, feeds them in the daytime, and he's ever present with his sheep, or he's not a shepherd. Your problem is we got a bunch of hirelings today that are not shepherds. A shepherd is one that's going to watch out for your spiritual welfare. And my friend, a lot of Christians sometimes are belly up legs kicking in the air, and they can't do a thing to save themselves. Simple. All the shepherd has to, you ought to watch it on YouTube. All the shepherd has to do is walk over and flip that sheep back over. It gets up on its legs and away it goes. Amen. Doesn't take a whole lot to save its life, but somebody's got to do it. And did you know that a sheep is not a very sure-footed animal? Because they can stumble here and stumble there, so they need a shepherd to constantly watch over them. Have you seen the goats as they climb around on the side of the mountains? How many's ever seen these goats? Amen. They know how to make their own way, don't they? That's a goat. There's a difference between a goat and a sheep. What is the difference? If you're born again today, you're a sheep. Amen. If you're butting all the time, you're a goat. So you can find your way, make your way. You can go into everything under the sun because you're a goat. But if you're a sheep, you need a shepherd. Amen. So who does come back from personal failure? The Bible has some. I want you to notice the book of Exodus, chapter number 2, verse 11. It talks about Moses. He killed an Egyptian. And my friend, this Egyptian was beaten an Israelite. You've heard the story 1,000 times. Here's the lesson to learn from it. Moses thought the time was right for him to serve the Lord and become the leader of his people. The Bible tells you in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 11, that he chose to suffer the affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. That's what Moses did. It was already working on his soul. He knew who his mother was. He knew it was not Pharaoh's daughter. Moses did not have an identity crisis. He knew he was a Hebrew and who he belonged to. But he missed the timing of God. Instead of God's time, he chose his time. And so that's where Moses made his mistake. Not that what Moses was trying to do was bad. It's just the timing was wrong. In the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law. Timing is very important with God. Maybe you tried to do something for the Lord, started some kind of a ministry. You did this, you did that, and it failed right before your eyes. Let me tell you something about failure. It's one of the greatest lessons God has to teach us with. Failure gets your attention, number one. Failure causes you to look at yourself, number two. Failure makes you seek the source of whatever it is that you need. We need God. We don't need organization nearly as bad as we need God. Organization is all right, but without God, it's twice dead and plucked up by the roots. So the time is very important. So maybe you made a decision in the past, it didn't work. Now you've quit, thrown your hands up, walked out of the church and said, God will never use me again. Yes, he will. Now you're ready. And God will do something. Job, the Bible said in Job chapter number 42, verses 1 through 10, he lost his wealth. He lost his family. He lost his health. He lost his friends. Most people would go out and blow their brains out. Amen. They commit suicide. That's what they did in 1929. These men were jumping out of skyscrapers when the market crashed in 29. They entered into the Great Depression. They were committing suicide everywhere because everything that they had built all of a sudden just vaporized before them. And they had nothing to live for. They happened. All you got to do is read your history books. This happened. This is a fact. They committed suicide. And so Job, everything he's got is taken away. His wife turns against him. So what has he done? He sticks with God. That's what he does. Amen. He stuck with him. And though everything looked like it had crashed, and there was no hope, and there was no future, he stuck with God. And the faith that Job had in God sometimes was so thin that you'd look like a hare. But he still held out. And when he held out, God blessed him in the end. For the Bible said, have you seen the end of Job? Where are you going to be when it's over with? Not where are you right now. Where will you be when it's over with? Where will you be a year from now? 5 years, 10 years from now? If the Lord doesn't come back in 10 years, where will you be? Will you be faithful to the Lord? Be serving God? Where will you be? Or are you like some who get all worked up and they get really emotional and they get fired up and they're ready to do this and they're ready to tackle the world and they're assault hell with a squirt gun? You've heard that. They're ready to do everything under the world. And all of a sudden, it seems like the rug gets jerked out from under them and they come crashing down. We've seen it right here. We've seen it right here at Temple Baptist Church. And I pray for them every day of my life. I cry out to God for them. For they come crashing down. My dear friend, God made you to be a blessing, and he will bless you. And he hath blessed us with all spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That means Satan cannot touch your blessing, for it is in heaven with the power and presence of God. So we have with Samson, when he lost his freedom, that's when Samson began to cry out to God. The prisons are full of Christians that are dedicated to the Lord, that are living for God, that are walking with the Lord. Some of the greatest Christians in this country are locked up in maximum security. I firmly believe that, because it is in there they came face to face with who they really were, and there they got right with God. David had all kinds of problems. You know how he was. He brought it upon himself because he committed murder, and then he tried to cover it up, and it started with adultery. And yet David ended well. The Bible says that God has the sure mercies of David. What did that preacher? He's the only one in the whole Bible from Genesis to Revelation that said about the sure mercies of David. The Bible teaches us that we have the mercies of David. We have that mercy. He's been merciful and he's been gracious to us. And I thank God for that. You say, God's getting tired of forgiving me. No, he's not. If you confess your sin, he's faithful and just to deliver, can cleanse you and deliver you from all unrighteousness. So we have David. We've got Elijah. We have one of, Elijah was a great warrior for God, but all it took was threatening his life, and Elijah took tail and he ran. Then we have Manasseh. Let's read about him. In the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter number 33, here's what it said. Wherefore the Lord brought upon them the captains of the host of the king of Assyria, which took Manasseh among the thorns, and bound him with fetters, and carried him to Babylon. Here's the king, taken in fetters and carried to Babylon. And when he was in affliction, he besought the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers and prayed unto him, and he was entreated of him and heard his supplication and brought him again to Jerusalem into his kingdom. Then Manasseh knew that the Lord, he was God, when he was in his affliction. My, some of us are so stubborn, so hard-headed, that it's going to take a sledgehammer to get our attention. It's going to take our whole world crashing down around us. It's going to take sitting in divorce court. It's going to take it's going to take ICU. It's going to take your children running off and leaving you. It's going to take your whole world crashing down around you for you to lift your head up to God and cry out to him and ask him to help you. Amen. I'm glad for one thing. When you do, he will. Yep. Hallelujah. Amen. John chapter 15 verse 5 says this. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. Let me read that again. Without me ye can do nothing. You can build all the buildings and build all the ministries and build all the reputations and build this and build that and do this and do that, but it's all dead works. And God will not bless it. This was a man who failed in business at the age of 21. He was defeated in a legislative race at 22. He failed again in business at age 24. He overcame the death of his sweetheart at age 26. He had a nervous breakdown at age 27. He lost a congressional race at age 34. Lost a senatorial race at age 45. Failed in an effort to become vice president at age 47. And lost a senatorial race at 49. You'd think this man is a failure. And then he was elected president of the United States at age 52. Abraham Lincoln. One day, a partially deaf 4-year-old kid came home with a note. in his pocket from his teacher. Your Tommy is too stupid to learn. Get him out of the school. His mother read the note and answered, My Tommy is not stupid to learn. I will teach him myself. And that Tommy grew up to be Thomas Edison. Thomas Edison had only 3 months of formal education, and he was partially deaf. And he was one of the greatest inventors this country ever had, by far. Thomas Edison was kicked out of school, never learned. The experts can be wrong. They can be wrong. They can be wrong. Don't let men and criticism and failure dictate your life. What matters is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, our risen Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you had a good godly mother, the God of your mother and the God of your father, that's who that you should be looking to today to change you. You can't change yourself. Can the leopard change his spots? No, you can't do it. Well, preacher, you're right, because I've tried it and tried it. No, you cannot change yourself. Reformation, New Year's resolutions, turning over a new leaf, starting again, you know, promises and promises. And you promise your wife, you promise your husband, you promise your children, you're not going to do it again, and you go right back out and do it again. You can't change yourself, but the Word of God. If you will believe what I've preached to you this morning about receiving His Word, if you'll receive it, if you'll believe what God said, He'll change you. And here's the first promise for you. If any man comes unto me, I will in no wise cast him out. If you'll come, he won't cast you out. Father, in Jesus' name, bless your holy word this morning. What I preached is for somebody. There may be somebody out there, Lord, that they've just given up and they're ready to quit. They're ready to kill themselves. Lord, we see that all the time now. We see teenagers committing suicide. It's an epidemic. The experts are trying to figure out what's wrong with them. They don't realize that they've lost their identity. They have no spiritual foundation. There's nothing of substance in their life. It's just all a bunch of nothing. I pray this morning, Lord Jesus, that your word will take root. It will not return unto you void. It'll accomplish that which you please and prosper in the thing whereto you've sent it. And we bless your sweet, righteous, holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, nobody looking, would you get up out of your seat? Come down to him one more time. Try him one more time. One more time, Lord, I'm going to come back. One more time. I've been down that road before. I've been down that road before. I've made promises, but I broke them. I didn't keep them. You helped me and you blessed me, and then I went right back doing the same thing again. God's showing you that you don't have it within yourself to do this, but He does. If you can receive His word, you have received life, and you've received the very foundation you need to do what I'm talking about. His word is life. Ezekiel, prophesy. Jeremiah, prophesy. Prophesy. Can these bones live? Prophesy. Speak to them. Speak to them. Well, preacher, there's nothing there to hear. The word is life, and it carries life, and it raises the dead, and it creates, it saves, it heals. The word of God does that. Not the messenger. I'm the messenger. It's the word that I'm preaching to you this morning. That'll do it. Not me.